Well, despite his youthful appearance, he's been an MP for more than a decade now, actually about a dozen years. I hate to say that Michael Chaun is becoming one of the older MPs because that would mean I'm becoming an older journalist, but Michael Chaun joins me now. He's one of the people seeking to be leader of the Conservative Party, and I only tease you about that, Michael, because we're about a month apart in terms of age, and I keep saying if Justin Trudeau's a young man, I'll take it.
Exactly.
We're all middle aged, really. Yeah. Let's face it.
Well, we're all the same age as Trudeau.
Exactly. why'd you decide to jump in on the leadership race? You know, you got all these thousands of people showing up to be part of the party, to decide what the future's like. What made you say, you know what, I can be part of that, I can lead that change?
Well, Brian, like you, my parents were immigrants to this country, and I owe everything to this country. I wouldn't be here today if it weren't for this country and the sacrifices that Canadian soldiers made during the Second World War.
Well, even more for your family than mine. I mean, my family owes the economic success we have, but you have an interesting story on both sides of your parents from different parts of the world.
Literally, you're right. Literally, thousands of Canadians died so that families like my father's and my mother's could live. My father was a young boy in Hong Kong when Canadian soldiers in the first land combat engagement of that war defended him and his family against a pretty vicious assault. Hundreds of those soldiers from the Royal Rifles of Canada and the Winnipeg Grenadiers died. And they never came home. They're buried on Hong Kong Island in a Canadian war cemetery. And my mother's family was liberated by Canadian soldiers during the same Second World War. 7,000 Canadian soldiers died in the Netherlands, and they too are buried in the fields of the Netherlands. My family, my mother's family was liberated by Canadian soldiers in the spring of 1945, and the Dutch have never forgotten that. So not only was my father and my mother's family defended and liberated by Canadians, after the war, they came to this country.
And so they met here, though?
They met here in Kingston, Ontario.
Okay.
And they got married and had four children. I'm one of them.
Well, let me ask you this then. I grew up in a neighborhood where if you were born and raised Canadian, you were the odd person out. Very immigrant-heavy neighborhood in Hamilton. Those were heavily liberal neighborhoods. So how'd a kid of two immigrants end up a conservative MP and someone who's been involved in conservative politics since he was a teenager?
Well, I had the mirror experience to you. I grew up in rural Ontario in a farming community in Wellington County. You know, I was a mixed race kid growing up in rural Ontario in the 1970s, and I was, you know, the odd one in my school. And so I grew up in this community. I believe in the values that this community stands for, and that's why I'm a conservative today, because I believe in the principles and the values on which our party is based. You know, individual liberty, free markets and free trade, belief in, you know, the importance of checks and balances on power. You know, those to me are conservative values.
When you made your announcement, you surprised me a little by your emphasis on personal freedoms and liberties. I wasn't expecting that, and I'm not sure why, but we just, even from conservative politicians, I don't think we hear enough of it. Talk to me a bit about why that needs to be emphasized in this day and age.
Well, I think individual liberties are the cornerstone of free and democratic societies. You know, we live in a modern era of technology and the internet and social media and, you know, ever-expanding ability of technology to reach into the very personal lives of a government, reaching into the very personal lives of their citizens. And so I think it's really important, especially in that regard, that we jealously defend individual liberty. So, for example, you know, we live in an age where we're in a global fight against terrorism and terrorist activities. And so governments have needed to put in place new tools, new legal tools, new laws in order to help them counter this terrorism threat. And that's fine, but with additional powers to surveil and to investigate citizens should come additional oversight of government intelligence and security operations. Why? In order to protect those sacrosanct principles of individual liberty.
Okay, the individual liberty is, people will say they preciously want to guard it on the internet. They want free speech on Twitter, they want free speech on Facebook. But we look elsewhere, Britain, as I now call it, once Great Britain, they allow people to be arrested for tweets. And tweets that we wouldn't even consider outrageous. I mean, you and I are in the public domain. The stuff that said about you, about me, yeah, from people that don't like us on Twitter, it'd make their hair curl in Britain. But now that's a crackdown on freedom of speech. But you've got young people saying they want freedom of speech in those outlets, and yet they've got speech codes on campus. and they're fine with that. So what would you say to young people that are okay with these speech codes and cracking down on political discourse that they don't like, but want the freedom online to say whatever they feel like?
Well, I would say to them that the clash of ideas and debate is the most important way in which we solve our differences in our society. Mm. You know, it wasn't that long ago, centuries ago, that we solved our differences at the tip of a sword. Well, we decided not to do that, and we decided to do it through open debate, where various ideas clash in the public realm and where the best ideas win. And so we must jealously guard that free speech, because it's the basis of our democracy. The ability for different groups of people to come together in a peaceful manner and to debate these ideas and come to a consensus on the way forward. If we limit free speech, we limit that democratic debate, and ultimately we undermine the very foundation of our democracy.
I know that with what you just said there, you're gathering a lot of people in the rebel nation and saying, hey, this guy sounds interesting. But when they hear that Michael Chong supports carbon tax, they go, oh, hold on a minute.
Well, I never said I supported a carbon tax vis-a-vis cap and trade. What I have said is that carbon pricing has already arrived in Canada. So two provinces in the west of the country have already put in place a carbon tax. British Columbia has had one in place for a decade. Alberta's just announced the implementation of one. Mm-hmm. And in central Canada, Quebec and Ontario are putting in a price on carbon through the Western Climate Initiative
with California.
That's right. And it's a cap and trade initiative. So, but the point to be made is carbon pricing has already arrived. The federal government has a role to play to ensure a consistent price on carbon across the country so we don't harm our economy, and also to ensure a consistent price across economic sectors. So this price has arrived. The question for conservatives is, what do we do with these revenues? And I believe strongly, where I differ strongly from liberals, is that I believe those revenues should be used to cut income taxes. Otherwise, these carbon revenues are nothing more than a tax grab.
So do you essentially see a price on carbon as a different form of consumption tax to displace income tax?
A price on carbon is another form of a consumption tax. And so one of the things that we could accomplish as conservatives compared to what the liberals are doing in Ontario is we can use these revenues to cut income taxes. And if we do that, not only will we achieve the primary goal of a reduction in emissions and pollution, we'll achieve a secondary goal that conservatives have always believed in, which is to shift taxation away from income, which we want more of, towards consumption. And that's always been a long-term conservative economic goal.
Let's talk a bit about your background before getting in. Not your family background. You've told that story. It's a compelling story. But often people will say, well, I don't want career politicians. You've been a politician for 12 years, but you did have a career before that. You were in IT, and you worked for the NHL Players Association, for goodness sakes. What the hell were you thinking getting into politics? That sounded like a pretty sweet job.
Well, Brian, that's what voters asked me when I first ran in Wellington, Halton Hills. Why would I leave the NHLPA to go and run for political office?
Because I'm betting you had good hockey tickets.
We did, actually. but, you know, I believe in this country. I believe that Parliament is our society's greatest invention. And by Parliament, I mean a democratic system of checks and balances on power. And that is the foundation of everything else in our society, our prosperity, our wealth, our stability. And if people want the proof of that, they just look around the world today. Some of the nations with the greatest natural resources are some of the poorest countries on the planet. And yet some countries like Japan and Germany, which have virtually no natural resources, are some of the wealthiest. What characterizes wealthy and stable societies is that democratic system of checks and balances, what we in Canada call Parliament. And that's why I'm in politics, because I believe in our system of government.
The current government wants to fundamentally change our Parliament. I know that you had a democratic reform bill that was out, and we've discussed it before. There's some parts I like, some parts I don't, some parts you've convinced me on. But where would you stand on where the current government is going, saying we've got to get rid of first past the post? Do we need to get rid of first past the post? It's thrown out there as if this is the worst invention ever. I think it's made us pretty successful so far.
Well, two things I'd say to the current Liberal government's approach. First, whatever changes to the electoral system the government proposes, it must be put to the people in a referendum. And the second thing I'd say is this. The primary problem that we have in Ottawa isn't the way in which we elect members of Parliament. It's what happens to those MPs once they're elected and they get to Ottawa. And the problem, quite simply, is that they're under the thumb of the PMO and party leaders, and they're unable to represent their constituents. They're too often controlled by a powerful party leader and PMO system. So that's where the fundamental problem is.
And I don't think many people realize that there are elements of that written into federal law.
That's right.
The powers of party leaders, it's not, I was talking about electoral reform on the radio the other day, and somebody called up and said, well, it's a private club, so you don't have any say. And I said, no, it's actually written into federal law, these powers that I think should be removed.
You're absolutely right, Brian. You know, the way I tell it to constituents back home in Wellington County and Halton Hills is that political parties are quasi-public institutions. In fact, arguably, they're public institutions because in order to become a member of parliament, in practical terms, you first have to get elected as a party candidate. In order to become a prime minister or a leader of the opposition in this country, in practical terms, you have to win a party leadership. And so if we argue that political parties are completely private and none of the public's business, what we are in effect saying is that we have privatized a portion of our system of government, the election of prime ministers and leaders of the opposition and the election of members of parliament. That part of the process is a private process.
How would you pry away the power of the center in all parties, not just the Conservatives, but the Liberals, the New Democrats, and I hate to admit they exist, but the Greens and the Bloc. So, I mean, they don't have official party status. But how would you peel that away for parties?
Well, there's a series of things we can do. Two of them just come to mind immediately. One is I don't think the Prime Minister should appoint the Speaker of the Senate. In Britain, the Speaker of the Lords is elected by members of the House of Lords themselves. So I think it's high time that the Speaker of the Senate be elected by senators themselves, just like we do in the House of Commons. Mm-hmm. That's one power we can take away from the Prime Minister's office. Second power is their power that they currently have to control parliamentary committees. We should remove the power of leaders, including the Prime Minister, to control parliamentary committees. Right now, the 10 members on a parliamentary committee sit at the pleasure of the party leaders, including the Prime Minister. I think at the beginning of every parliament, MPs should come together when they elect the Speaker and also elect committee members that would sit there for the life of that parliament until the next election so that they have the autonomy to hold the government accountable in front of committee, to review spending, and also to amend government legislation.
All right, Michael Chong, it's been great talking to you. Interesting ideas. You're welcome back here at The Rebel anytime.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks for watching. Click here to never miss a Rebel update. Want even more of The Rebel? Well, click here to become a premium member.